What is the mind? What is mindfulness? And how can we be more mindful? These three questions we will address, and we will address them as three parts of this talk. So let's begin with the verse 6:5. It's the next slide. उद्धरेदात्मनात्मानं नात्मानमवसादयेत् आत्मैव यात्मनो बन्धुर् आत्मैव रिपुरात्मनः. सो उद्धरेत् आत्मनात्मानं. कृष्णा इज़ सेइंग हियर, एलिवेट योरसेल्फ. आत्मनात्मानं नात्मानं अवसादयेत्. सो द वर्ड कृष्णा इज़ यूजिंग इज़ आत्मा. That Atmaiva ya Atmano Bandhur. That Atma, the self, is the friend of the self. Atmaiva Ripur Atmanaha. The Atma is the friend of the Atma. The Atma is the enemy of the Atma. Therefore, elevate the Atma with the Atma. And don't degrade the Atma with the Atma. So, that is, now here the word Atma. The Atma word has many different meanings. Atma is, it can mean broadly speaking the essence. So sometimes the Atma can refer to the soul, sometimes the Atma can refer to God, sometimes the Atma can refer to, like we have Dehatma Buddhi. So if somebody thinks of their self to be the body, then the word Atma can refer to the body, the mind, the God. So different things. So here the word refers to the mind. So it is saying, the verse is saying, elevate yourself with the mind and don't degrade yourself with the mind. So the mind can be your friend and the mind can be your enemy also. So this is quite an intriguing verse. What does it actually mean? So let's discuss this. So first we'll discuss, what is the mind? Yeah, can we go ahead? So in this verse, there are two senses of the word self. So one is that there is the elevator, that you elevate yourself, don't degrade yourself. That means there is a sense of the mind, or a sense of the self rather, which is the observer and the chooser. Okay, so you have to choose whether you'll be elevated or you'll be degraded. So that is the soul. And there is another sense of the mind, which is the suggester or the distractor. Let's do this. Let's try that out. Let's do that. So, if we consider within ourselves, say for example, right now you are attending this talk. So, while you are attending this talk, it may be that a part of you wants to focus on this talk. But suddenly another part might say, hey, you know, I was cooking that food, did I turn on the gas over there? Or, you know, what is this person doing over there? I need to check it out. I got a message on my phone. What is the message? Let me check it. So there is a part within us which keeps distracting us. Do this, do this, do watch this. So what is that distracting part? That is the mind. So Krishna is telling over here that the distractor that is there, it can be your enemy. Now, the mind can sometimes come up with good ideas also. It's not that always all the ideas are bad. So whenever it comes up with good ideas, that's like it's offering suggestions, and then those can be accepted. But before they can be accepted, they need to be evaluated. In fact, this capacity to abstract ourselves from ourselves. Abstract ourselves means to distance ourselves from ourselves and look at ourselves from another perspective. This is a distinctive human capacity that enables us to become self-aware. So for example, we can become aware. Hey, I'm becoming angry now. So, we may sometimes notice it by the reaction of others. If others are surprised, when they, oh, why are you yelling? Oh, was I yelling? I didn't want to actually. But so, somebody else might speak something and then we might become aware of it. If we are doing something. But sometimes we ourselves become, now I am feeling angry. Now I am feeling annoyed. Now I am feeling disheartened. So, this capacity to be aware of ourselves, that I am here. But I am also experiencer. I am the experiencer of the emotions, but I am also the observer of the emotions. This is what I am feeling. But is it worth, I am bugged by this. I am irritated by this. Is this really worth getting irritated about? That's a question which needs to be asked. So, that way, we can understand that there are multiple levels of the self, and within that the observer and the suggester, we could say, or the chooser and the distractor. And now when we talk about the mind, how does it function? So it functions, suppose we are driving a vehicle, say we are driving a car, and somebody else is also there in the car, sitting next to us, and that person keeps constantly distracting us. Hey, did you see that billboard? Did you see it? See, the new shop has opened over there. Did you see there's a new movie in that theater? Let's go there. Hey, what's that? I can't identify that. Let's go and have a look. Suppose somebody is driving a car and somebody is constantly distracting them from the car. Look at this, look at that. Now, it's one thing to, if we have paused the car and we are discussing something, it's one thing. But while driving, if we constantly let ourselves get distracted, then we could get into trouble. So the observer is the soul and the distractor is the mind. So now what is significant is the mind is not driving the car literally. It is sitting next. So the mind can propose, it can't impose. It can say, let's do this, let's watch this, let's go there. It can propose. Now, depending on how much the soul listens, then the mind's suggestions get implemented or not implemented. So the soul, the mind is not in the driver's seat. The mind can only propose, the mind can't impose. But the mind can propose so persuasively, so seductively, so shrewdly, that we don't even realize that it's the mind's proposition. We just accept it as our own idea and act on it. But the mind suggests and distracts while we are trying to, say, drive the car of our body in the journey of life. So to understand this in more metaphysical terms, we have all discussed about this example before. This, the soul is like the user, the mind is like the software, and the body is the hardware. This is a standard metaphor. So our existence is three level: body, mind and soul. So now what does the mind do? So there is a way in which the mind functions to distract us, but that is not the only role of the mind. We may say that, okay, why do I need the mind also? The mind is constantly distracting me. But the mind is not just like a person sitting next to us and distracting us. The mind is also our link to the world. Just like a user, if we have got a computer but it has no hardware installed on it, then we will not be able to use it at all. We won't be able to function at all. We need hardware. We need software to interface with the hardware. So similarly, for us to link with the world, for us to function with the world, we need the mind. Next slide. So the mind, what does it do? It integrates the inputs from the senses and presents them to the soul. Just like if there is a house with 5 doors, or there is a high security building with 5 entrances, then there might be security cameras at each of those entrances. And those are all integrated and brought to the control center, where there is a security in charge who sits and observes all of them. So like that, the inputs from all the senses are brought together and presented to the soul by the mind. Yeah, next. This is what Krishna tells later in the Bhagavad Gita. Shrotram chakshu sparshanam cha rasanam granam eva cha adhishthaya manashchayam vishayanupasevate. So, adhishthaya manashchayam. The first two lines describe the 5 senses. Shrotra, ear, chakshu, eyes. Shrotram, chakshu, sparshanam cha. Sparsha is touch. Rasanam is taste, tongue. Ghranam is nose, smell. So, we take in inputs from these 5 senses. These are called as the knowledge acquiring senses, jnanendriyas. So, we take in input from those senses, and adhishthaya manashchayam. They are all integrated around the mind. They are all integrated through the mind, rather. Just like we have 5 fingers in the hands. The 5 fingers are centered around the palm. they are they come and they're joined at the palm. So like that, the five senses are joined at the mind, and then Vishayan Upasevate, the soul, through this mechanism of the senses in the mind, tries to enjoy various worldly sense objects. Through the five senses, we perceive, okay, what is attractive over here? What is it that I want to enjoy? And we go toward those objects and seek to enjoy them. Next. So the soul is, to understand this in another way, so the soul is the link. So the soul is the root, R-O-O-T, the source of consciousness. And the mind is the route of consciousness, the channel through which consciousness comes. So the soul is here, the mind is here, the body is here. And the consciousness of the soul comes through the mind to the body and to the outer world. However, the mind is not just a route of consciousness. So now till now I have talked about two roles of the mind. One is, it is like a distractor, suggester distractor. The other is the route. Now what is it? At a functional level, it is meant to be simply like a route. But it is not just a route. Say, if we have a pipeline through which water is meant to go. But suppose some chemicals have been put into that. So the walls of the pipeline are coated with some chemicals over there. Then what happens? The water will not just pass through as it is through the pipeline, but the water will get contaminated by that. And the water that comes in might be pure water, but the water that comes out will be contaminated water. So the mind, so our consciousness, that means our capacity to perceive, that channels through the mind, but because the mind has its own impressions, so while that light of awareness is going through the mind, it gets contaminated, it gets filtered, it gets channeled in a particular way. So say we enter into a room. Now if say normally we would observe what all is there in the room, but suppose we are very attached to, say, up to a particular sport, say cricket, then the first thing we will look, is there a TV over here? I can watch the TV and can see what is the cricket score right now. If somebody is very attached to, say, food, then they enter into the room, they don't see other things, they see the food directly. So in that sense, what is happening, the consciousness is coming through the mind, but because the thought, the desire, the craving for food is so strong within them, that their consciousness gets directed in that way. So the mind is both a transmitter of consciousness and a distorter, or a direct, it directs the consciousness in a particular way, and often not necessarily in a healthy way. So when Krishna is saying, Uddharet Atmanatmanam Natmanam Avasadayet, that elevate yourself with the mind and don't degrade yourself. What he means is that know that the mind is going to be a filter of going to be a transmitter and filter or distorter of consciousness. So observe how the consciousness is getting distorted by the mind, and then decide whether that is healthy or unhealthy, that is desirable or undesirable. So the transmission should happen in a way that is constructive for us, not destructive for us. So that brings us to the next point, that is, go ahead, next slide. So we discussed till now what is the mind. So the mind often is referred to as enemy. Krishna says over here in this particular verse, which we are discussing now, that the mind has four distinct attributes. 634 is a well-known verse. Chanchalam himana Krishna pramathi balavadrudham tasyaham nigraham manye vayorivasudushkaram. So Krishna says, sorry, this is not Krishna, this is Arjuna speaking, that the mind is extremely difficult to control. Why is it difficult? Because of these four attributes. So what are we discussing right now? How does the mind distort the consciousness that flows through it? It distorts because it is firstly restless. Chanchala. Chanchala is an adjective often used to refer to children. They just don't stay focused one place. If a mother tells a child, okay, sit and study over here. And the child, mother goes to the other room and starts doing some other work. If she comes back after half an hour or an hour, it's extremely unlikely that the child will be sitting peacefully and studying over there. Because that's not the way children function. Children are such that they often, their minds wander. So chanchala, the child might be playing, child might be gone here, gone there. So the mind is restless. However, it's not just restless, it is also reasonless. Reasonless means once it's irrational. Once the mind gets attached to something, pramati, it's mad. Once it wants something, it just wants it and wants it and wants it. So sometimes a child may have one toy which is actually a good toy, but a neighboring child has another toy which is not that good. But still, I want that toy and I want it and I want it right now. No, we don't have. We will go later. But go to the shop and buy it. No, I want it now. So what happens? The mind is like a child, but it is reasonless. You can't make a reasoning argument and try to make it see sense. It's difficult. It's reasonless. Pramati. Now, at least the child can be, the child is physically small, the parents can sometimes scold the child and control the child. But the mind is ruthless. It's balavat. You know, it's strong, it's ruthless. In that sense, the mind is like a bully. So rather than we using the force to control it, sometimes it seems to use this force and it starts intimidating us. Do this, do this, do this, do this. And it seems to have made it make our inner world like a hell. It seems like we are living psychologically tortured, goaded. This is what happens when somebody is addicted and they are craving for something. Do it, do it, do it, do it. And they don't want to, but it's unbearably miserable for them. Because when the mind starts demanding something, it's like a bully who ruthlessly torments us. Now, earlier I said the mind mind can only propose, it can't impose. Yes, that's true, but it can propose in such a demanding way that it can seem like an imposition. And it's not only balavat, it is drudham. Drudham is it's relentless. That means it's not just now, it just keeps asking, keeps craving. I want it, I want it, I want it. It's not that the craving by itself may not go away. It is prasangam ajaram pasham atmanah kavayo viduhu. The Bhagavatam says that the body grows old, but our attachments, they do not grow old. Jara is old age. Ajara is that which does not grow old. So prasangam ajaram pasham. So prasanga, that the pasha, the noose, the shackles of attachment are ajara. They never grow old. So the mind has its cravings which constantly keep distracting us. Now there is a whole industry which traditionally it was that we all engage in worldly activities, and then as we grow older, then say beyond 50, a person meant to retire or at least reduce their material engagements and focus on spiritual growth. So now there is a whole industry which focuses on targeting old people with sensuality. And there are all kinds of old age. Now you fulfill your responsibilities. Now go to this party and go to this sightseeing. Go here, do this, enjoy this. So although the body might not be that fit, but the mind is still filled with craving. And then the culture, the media, they all further fuel the mind. So what happens is, because of these four attributes, the mind can be a fearsome enemy. And going against it can seem extremely difficult. So Arjuna tells Krishna that vayoriva sudushkaram, that when the mind starts demanding something, it starts flowing so fast, it starts blowing, that trying to stop it seems to be like stopping the wind. What do you do? How do we stop the wind? It's almost impossible. Sudushkaram, he says. So that is, this is understanding the mind. The mind is meant to function as a link, as a transmitter of consciousness. But while transmitting, it often distorts our consciousness. Let's go to the next slide. So, what is mindfulness? Yeah, next. Mindfulness means that basically it means to be aware of our situations and our emotions. And going back to the earlier driving metaphor, a driver needs to be aware of the road on which they are driving, and the driver needs to also have some awareness of what the person next to them is doing. If their full conscious attention is given to the person next to them, then they will not be able to drive properly. If no attention is given to them, then that person might spring a surprise and they will be caught unawares. So we need to be aware of physical reality. We also need to be aware of how we are reacting to physical reality at an emotional level. What kind of feelings are coming up within us? What are the thoughts that are popping up within us? So it's like, as I said earlier, the example of the control center, from where there are five doors, from which the closed circuit TV cameras are routed to the control center. So now the security in charge should be observing all the windows and then focus on the window that is important. Hey, this character looks a little suspicious. Who is that person? Let's zoom it. And then it expands and observe. Oh, okay, this is what is happening over here. Okay, this person, maybe we need to check their identity more carefully. So then it might tell the person over there, the security in charge over there, look for more identity proof or keep an eye on this person, whatever. And so now that is how, while all the five senses are giving us inputs, but we consciously focus on some of the senses. So right now, you might be sitting and hearing. While sitting, you might feel that, oh, my back is not so comfortable. My legs are, I want to stretch my legs a little bit. So all those are physical sensations. They're coming in. But you may decide, okay, this is not a long class. Maybe half an hour more. So I can stretch afterwards. Or right now, okay, I can stretch, but I don't have to pay much attention after that. So you might decide, so that input comes in, that's like one window which is there, something is coming on the window of touch, of sensation, and then you decide whether that needs to be maximized or that can be kept minimized. So you would like at this stage, say the window of sound and the window of sight to be maximized so that you can focus and you can take in what is being spoken. But at the same time, while we want to choose and decide which windows are to be maximized and which to be minimized, but also what happens is that the mind has its own programming by which some windows might automatically get maximized or minimized. So that's what happens, for example, when somebody is very attached to something. Then suddenly that window just pops up and our full attention goes over there. So which window is it, what is popping up, which window is getting maximized, we need to be aware of that. So suppose the security in charge is, say, supposed to look at the various doors, but suppose at that time say something else pops up on the computer. Maybe some notification of a Facebook page or something like that. Now the security charge starts looking at that, and then some suspicious person, some attacker slips in. That could cause a lot of danger. So there could be distraction that can come from the device. The device, the computer screen is meant to help the security in charge function properly, but it can distract. So like that, our mind is meant to help us focus on and function in the physical reality, but it can distract us. So we need to be aware both of our physical situation and of our mental emotions. In Hindi we say paristhiti and manasthiti. So what is the external situation? What is the internal situation? We are aware of both, that is being mindful. Can you go ahead? So the word mindful, now, what does it mean literally? It does not mean full of the mind. What it means is don't fool with the mind. I repeat, what it means, not full of the mind. It doesn't mean that we pay full attention to the mind alone. Rather, we understand that the mind can be a distractor and we don't let ourselves get too distracted by the mind. Don't fool with it. Don't fool with it means that don't tamper with it. Don't unnecessarily dally around it. Don't tarry around it. Don't provoke it. So don't fool around with it. So basically, just do the needful. Be aware of it and process it. Don't fool around. So mindful, if we are not mindful, our mind will make us a fool. So here, I would like to take a little detour. And when we talk about the word mindful, this also, this particular sense of the word mindful also brings us to the point that the word mind can have multiple meanings. In the Bhagavad Gita's philosophical context, I explained to you what the mind means. That there is a soul, there is the body, and there is a link between the soul and the body, that is the mind. However, in common parlance, in general usage, the word mind can mean many different things. So, for example, we might use this word, have you lost your mind? Now, when we use the word, have you lost your mind? What does it mean? It means, have you lost your intelligence? Have you become mad? Why are you speaking or doing like this? So, when we use the word, have you lost your mind? That we are using the word mind in the sense of the intelligence. Or we might use the word mind. Give this your full mind. Where is your mind? What we mean by that is, where is your attention? So the word mind can also refer to attention. The word mind can also sometimes refer to an intelligent person. Say Einstein was one of the greatest scientific minds of the last century. So when we use the word over their mind, it refers to an intelligent person. So the word mind can have different meanings. Another meaning of the word mind can be, say, sometimes people use the word mind over matter. Mind over matter, or in philosophy it is a mind-matter duality. So in that sense, what they say, in that philosophical sense, what the word mind means is that there is the world of matter we perceive and there is something beyond that, and that is called the mind. So in Western philosophy, the mind is often equated with everything non-material. So there is the physical level of reality, that is the external world, and everything that is non-physical, that is generically referred to as a mind. So mind over matter is used to refer to that. Now, don't let the material stimuli control you. Raise your consciousness above and control yourself. So mind and matter duality. So the word mind can have many different meanings. So when we say be mindful, here the word mindful means be thoughtful. Use your intelligence. Be aware. So here the word mind is used in the sense of, when we use the word be mindful, there the word mind is used in the sense of intelligence and attention. Be attentive. Be intelligent. Be aware. Be mindful. So if these different senses of the word mind are confusing for you, then no need to bother too much about it. But if you were already confused because because the mind is used in different senses, then you can get a sense of what the word mind is, what the word mind means in different contexts. In philosophy of language, it is a fundamental truth that the meanings of words are not present only in the dictionary. The meanings of the words are also present in the context in which they are used. So, in some ways, a word is like a chess piece. You know, a chess piece, it is just a piece. If it is off the chessboard, you might say, what is this? Oh, this is shaped like a horse. It has a head shaped like a horse. Whatever. But the chess, we cannot make much sense of the chess piece without knowing the rules of chess. And not only the rules of the chess we need to know, but also where is this piece placed right now? Sometimes a pawn might be at a very critical position, and because of that, its value might be enormous, and sometimes it might be not so much. So like that, words are always to be understood in their context. So generally, when we in our Bhagavad Gita discussions will use the word mind, we generally use it in that sense. It's the link between the soul and the body, and the link, instead of simply sometimes linking, it can also distract. So, but when then the word mindful is used, it is used in the sense of be thoughtful, be aware, be attentive. Okay, go ahead, please. So, now we come to the last part of the discussion. How can we be more mindful? So, why am I using the word more mindful? Because we are mindful to some extent. Say, for example, right now, you're hearing a class, and at that time, you're aware. Okay, I need to focus on this. So, if you get distracted, I don't want to be distracted. So, we all have the capacity to be aware, to be attentive, but we would all benefit if we could enhance it. That's why we're discussing how can we be more mindful? How can we be more aware of what we are doing, what we are feeling, so that we can be focused? So we'll talk based on the 6th chapter of the Gita, 3 principles. Yeah, can you go to the next slide? So this is the word pit, P-I-T. Now pit can refer to something like a ditch in which you fall down, but pit can also mean pit your wits. So it's like we have to confront. So we have to confront the mind, and we have to be, so say India is pitted against Pakistan in a cricket match, or so and so player is pitted against that player. So when we are pitted against the mind, how can we come out successful? For that there are these 3 things. We need to have persistence, intelligence, and transcendence. So persistence refers to the need for repeated practice. Intelligence refers to that we need to not just practice, but we need to direct our practice using our thoughtfulness, our intelligence. So transcendence refers to the object, that we need to have an object for focusing on, and that object is transcendence. So by that we will be able to improve. So let's look at this. Can we go ahead, next slide? Persistence means, like, this is 626 in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, yato yato nishchalati manaschanchalam asthiram tatastato niyamyaitad atmanyaiva vasham nayet. So wherever and whenever the mind wanders, bring it back under the control of the self, Krishna says. Wherever and whenever the mind wanders, yato yato nishchalati. So Krishna is telling over here, the mind will wander, and don't expect that you decide that you want to focus and immediately the next day the mind will be focused. No, the mind will wander. You will have to refocus it. So persistence. So if you consider the mind to be like a child, the child is not going to grow up and become a mature adult in a day or a week. It will take time. So similarly for our mind, which is restless, for it to mature, it will take time. And we need to be patient. We need to be perseverant. We need to be persistent. So the mind wanders, refocus. Mind wanders, refocus. And in fact, this is the single critical thing required for mindfulness and for meditation. If you want to chant our mantras while practicing bhakti, chanting Hare Krishna, in meditation, mind wanders, bring it back. The mind will stray away, don't let it stay away. It will stray away, that's just the nature, but don't let it stay away. and don't get tired. You have to persist. So each time we focus the mind, actually, it is slowly getting trained. It is slowly getting disciplined. It might appear as if every day we are starting at the bottom of a mountain, and every day we struggle to climb, and we slip, and we go up a little bit, and again we slip, and next day we may feel like, oh, I'm starting again at the bottom of the mountain. That's how it feels when dealing with the mind, because the mind tends to be restless. However, just by the habit of refocusing, we are training the mind, we are improving. The results may not be apparent, but we are taking steps forward. So persistence is the first thing. And next slide. The next is I is intelligence. So intelligence means that the mother, it should not just be waiting for the child to grow up. The mother is feeding the child, and the child is not studying, then the mother focuses the child. The child starts pulling, hey, come back, study now. So there is feeding the child, means that means giving the child what will nourish it, and it's focusing. So the child may not focus, but the mother has to focus. So the intelligence has to be like the mother. The child will be like, the mind will be like a child, but the intelligence has to be the mother. And then the mother, what also does, she does, it's guarding and guiding. So guarding means that don't do this, or don't let this happen. Guiding means do this. So broadly, there are prescriptions and proscriptions, do's and don'ts. So guiding is what is to be done. Guarding is what is to be avoided. So the mind has to be, in this way, mentored. It has to be helped to grow up. Just persistence alone is not enough. There has to be intelligence guiding that persistence. It is just like, suppose somebody wants to become a top-notch archer. Say they want to win Olympic gold in archery. Now they have to shoot many, many arrows. They have to practice. So it's not that the first time you shoot, you are going to hit the bullseye. Practice, 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 practice. But so that's the practice is the persistence part. The any Olympic archer who hits the bullseye in the Olympic championship and wins gold, they have shot maybe hundreds, thousands, maybe millions of arrows at various targets throughout their lives. That's the practice that is required. Still, the important thing now again is that it's not just practice. It's not that the archer can close the eye and shoot wherever they want. Each time the archer has to try their best to focus and hit at the target. Hit at the target. So persistence is important, but intelligence is also required. Hey, last time I went so much off, why? Okay, because my arm was like this. Maybe I should keep the arm like this. Maybe this front arm I should keep like this. Maybe the arrow has to be kept like this. So maybe this bow doesn't work for me. I don't need another bow. Maybe I'm better shooting from the right side rather than the left side. Whatever. I have to use the intelligence to ensure that the arrow is able to go toward the target and hit it better and better. So like that, while we are trying to focus the mind, we need to use our intelligence to find out what are the things that can help it focus. So what are the things that distract? So guarding and guiding means that, okay, if I sit down to study scripture, what are the things that can help me to study scripture? If I want to study the Bhagavad Gita, what are things, maybe if I keep a picture of Krishna next to me, that inspires me, this is Krishna message that I am studying. Or, you know, if I recite the Gita's verses, I have some recorded recitation. As I recite this, I feel myself in a more spiritual frame of mind. And then maybe that helps me. So guiding. And then what is it that distracts me? What do I have to guard against? Oh, if I keep my phone right next to me, or if my phone is maybe not in a flight mode, or it's in normal mode, then it can just ring at any time. It may distract me. This is what I don't want to do. So what do we need to do? We need to be focused. So we need to guard, we need to guide. So like that, similarly feeding and focusing. What is it that helps or nourishes our conviction so that we can focus. We do those things. So basically, this intelligence plays a very important role in focusing the mind. Chaitanya Charitamrita says, Siddhanta baliya chitte na kare alas, iha haite Krishna lage sudrudha manas. Siddhanta baliya. Don't think that, oh, this is all philosophy stuff. I'm not interested in this. Na kare alas. Don't be lazy about it. Why? If you think, I just want to absorb myself in Krishna and relish Krishna, I want to just have the bhakti rasa. Just, even if you want the bhakti rasa, the sweetness of bhakti, iha haite Krishna lage sudrudha manas. It is a philosophical study which is done with intelligence. We understand that it is spiritual reality that is enduring. It is Krishna who is the ultimate substantive principle. And by that we will be able to focus. So, that way we can move forward. And we can use our intelligence to focus. And lastly, go ahead please. So, intelligence is 625 was that shanai shanai ruparame buddhyadruti gruhitaya atma samstam manah krutva na kinchid api chintayet. Buddhyadruti gruhitaya. With intelligence sustained by conviction, we need to move forward. So intelligence, and then transcendence. Transcendence means what is the object that we are focusing on. Sometimes, now we will talk about meditation more in a future class, but here the focus is on when we meditate, what exactly are we, what is the object of meditation? Some people may say, oh, the object of meditation, I just focus on the tip of the nose. Somebody may say, I focus on some candle. Well, all this is good. Some object of focus is better than no object. But if there is a divine object of focus. There is Krishna, who is the all-attractive supreme being. We focus on him, then gradually the mind starts finding rest in him. It takes time, but the difference between other objects and Krishna is that with respect to other objects, we have to endeavor to focus. But with respect to Krishna, he is all attractive and he's all pure, he's all purifying. So once we get connected with Krishna, once we start getting absorbed in Krishna, then Krishna, that focus on Krishna will purge our heart of other distracting impurities within us. They'll purge our mind of the impurities. And in that way, a focus on Krishna will enable us to become absorbed. So that's Yoginam api sarvesham madgatena antaratmana shraddhavan bhajate yomam sameyuktatamo mataha. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, last verse of the 647 chapter, that's the next verse, next slide can we go to, that among all the yogis, the topmost are those who focus their mind on me. So transcendence, Krishna is the supreme transcendental reality, and we focus on him, and that's how the mind can be best managed. So last slide. So we take mindfulness to its fullness by making the mind full of Krishna. That means we try to surround ourselves with Krishna stimuli. We fill our consciousness with the intention to serve Krishna. So inner remembrance, outer service. By that way, when our mind is full with Krishna, then mindfulness goes to its fullness. And we can experience the full joy of living by absorption in Krishna. So I'll summarize what I discussed today. I focused on the topic of mind primarily. So we started by discussing what is the verse saying. It talks about two senses of the self. One as the chooser, the observer chooser, the other as the suggester distractor. So we could say the suggester distractor is the mind and the chooser is the soul. Then functionally, what is the mind meant to do? The mind is meant to be like the route for consciousness, which is coming from the soul, which is the root. However, So the mind is like the software which integrates with the various stimuli and brings them to the soul for presentation. Like the security in charge gets the inputs from the various doors to a high security building. But the mind also acts as a distractor, because if you're driving a car, the mind is like a person sitting next to us and constantly distracting us. So when we say we want to be, so the mind is considered to be an enemy because of its four attributes. It's restless, chanchala, it's reasonless, pramathi, it is ruthless, balavad, and it is relentless, drudham, it's obstinate. So what does it mean to be mindful? It means to be aware of our situations and aware of our emotions. That means we are aware of our physical, we the spiritual conscious, spiritual being consciousness, we're conscious of the physical reality as well as the mental reality. So then we discussed about mind, the various senses of the word mind. It can refer to attention, intelligence, it can refer to the non-material arena, it can refer to also the link between the body and the mind. And then lastly, we discussed how can we be more mindful, persistence, intelligence, and transcendence. Like a child takes time to grow up, so we need to be patient and keep focusing on the mind. And intelligence, being just like a archer, can't just keep shooting. Archers use the intelligence to increase their capacity to hit on the target. Like that, we have to use our intelligence to try to focus. And transcendence means that we focus on the all-attractive supreme, who is not just a passive object of concentration, but who is an active source of purification. And as we focus on Krishna, the various distracting influences within the mind get purged out. And that's how we take mindfulness to the fullness by focusing on Krishna. So let's look at some questions now. So why are we more attracted toward the sense objects? And even great sages, after long practice, fall for some temptation, and what is the hope for us? Firstly, it's all based on the impressions within the mind. That whatever are the impressions within the mind, those are the propositions that keep coming again and again. So because we have ourselves indulged in lust, anger and greed in the past, that's why we are attracted toward them. If we persist in the practice of bhakti, gradually what will happen is those impressions will be formed within us. And those impressions will gradually attract us toward Krishna. That's why this is patience that is required. As I said, the persistence part is required. And persistence can take a long time, but purification does happen gradually. Now, just like say somebody is not an alcoholic, if they pass by a bar, they don't feel much of agitation. But somebody is alcoholic, they pass by a bar, and even before they come to a bar, their thoughts are already inside the bar. So why? Because those impressions are there based on the past indulgence. So for us, the indulgence might be from this life, from a previous lives. But because of those indulgences and the impressions that have been created by those, we are attracted toward those particular objects. So now, as far as great failures, having some relaxes, so we need to understand that managing the mind is probably the toughest thing in all of existence. And in any challenging area of life, we look at the people who are successful and get inspiration from them. And we look at those who are not successful and see if we can learn some lessons from them. I was talking the example of winning Olympic gold. Now, every year, thousands upon thousands of athletes practice and dream and hope to win the Olympic gold. Among them, only one wins every 4 years. So now, if all those who are practicing start thinking of all those who did not succeed, then they will just lose heart. Similarly, in the scriptures, we are given stories of characters who failed and characters who succeeded. So we look at the characters who succeeded and take inspiration from them, and we move forward. And those characters who failed, we try to look at some life lessons from them. What did they do wrong? So, and we try to avoid those things. So yes, it is a challenge, and we need to be ready for that challenge. It's not an easy thing. And just like even champion athletes might flounder at the last lap and may not win. So it's possible that somebody who has gone a long way, they may flounder and they may not complete. But in the future session, we'll be discussing how, whereas in material life, if we don't succeed, we lose, and we may lose everything. But in spiritual life, whatever progress we have made, it stays with us forever. So even if we fall, actually, it's neither irreversible loss, nor is it actually not are we starting from scratch. We are actually, it's just a temporary distraction. It's not actually a degradation. Our spiritual assets are never lost. We'll discuss that more in a future session. So whatever progress we make, it always stays with us. And that's why we need to be always positive and hopeful in growing in pursuing to go spiritually. Okay, there are a lot of questions today. So when somebody has paranoia or bipolar, what is the state of their minds? There is another subject in this, but there's another question which I'm also answering over here. Does the mind refer to the brain or the heart? Well, actually speaking, the mind is different. The brain is a part of the hardware. Just like in a computer, there might be a CPU. So the brain is like the CPU. The CPU, central processing unit, is a part of the hardware. The brain is a part of the physical body. The mind is non-physical. So the mind is something which is subtle, different from the body. So different from the brain also, which is a part of the body. Now, when we talk about the word heart, the heart word itself has multiple meanings. Sometimes we refer to the biological heart when we say somebody's got a heart attack. But sometimes when we use the word heart as the center of emotions, when we say, you know, that person broke my heart. It's not that the biological organ heart has been broken, but rather it is the center of our emotion, the seat of our emotions, that is where we have been wrecked. So in that sense, when we refer to the mind, we refer to the heart as the source of as the source or seat of emotions. The heart can refer to the mind or the soul, depending on where our emotions are situated primarily. So in a pure spiritual sense, the heart refers to the soul. But quite often when our emotions come from the mind, then we are referring to the mind. So our desire generated from the mind or the soul. Desires can come from various sources. They can come from the body and the physical level. We see some object and we get the desire for it. Desires can come from the mind. That means say alcoholic sees a bar and gets the desire to drink. Or the alcohol has the desire in the mind and then goes to a bar. So desires can come from the physical to the mental, or they can come within the mental level and they can go to the physical level also when we act on those desires. Now, the desiring capacity comes from the soul. If there is no consciousness, then no desire can come. So from the soul, what comes is consciousness. And consciousness is what enables various desires to pop up and desires to be chosen. Now, can desires come from the soul also? Yes, in a pure spiritual state, the desires come from the soul. At our stage, very few desires are coming from the soul. Most of them are coming from the mind, and we are choosing or not choosing them. Desires for spiritual growth, desires for Krishna, those at a pure state, they just burst forth from the soul. At our level, even our desire for Krishna is more of sometimes we like something about Krishna, so our mind likes the music, mind likes the prasad, or our intelligence, it makes sense of those things. So in that sense, most of our desires presently are coming from the subtle body or from the outer world. And that's why we need association. When we have association, then our spiritual desires are stimulated. But the capacity to desire comes from the soul, and pure desires will also arise from the soul. So now, with this understanding, when we go back, what happens whenever there is bipolar or paranoia? Well, basically, these are just names given to certain states of the brain. And the whole area of psychiatry and even psychology is filled with a lot of confusion. Just like with respect to pathogens, when they infect a person, then you can say this particular germ, this particular virus, this particular bacteria has infected the person, and therefore they have this disease. But with respect to mental health, it's not that there are no pathogens that can be isolated or identified. That's why the same person, if they go to different psychiatrists, they might give different diagnosis for the person. That's and in fact, there's a famous or infamous experiment that was done by a mentally healthy person in UK who went to different psychiatrists and described these different symptoms. And what happened was they all diagnosed them differently. So that's why these are names, and I won't go into the technicalities of the names, but broadly speaking, what happens is that the mind and the body, brain, are closely related. Just like I want to speak, but if my throat is damaged, I can't process and produce sound. Similarly, if the brain is damaged, then the capacity to process and produce thought as it is manifested at a physical level for us to function, that can be impeded. So if there is a clear structural or biochemical damage to the brain, then some psychiatric intervention in terms of medicine can be helpful. But functionally speaking, whenever there is a mental disorder, what happens? The soul is here, the mind is here, the body is here. As I said, the mind is meant to be a channel for the soul, for the soul's consciousness to get rooted through. But sometimes there is a complete misalignment, or the significant misalignment. That means the soul's consciousness goes through the mind to an alternate level, to a kind of dysfunctional perception. And the person, people can have hallucinations, people can have various kinds of false perceptions. So ideally speaking, the mind, the soul, mind and body have to be in one line by which healthy functioning can happen. But when there is misalignment, the greater the misalignment, the greater are the mental health problems. When we say somebody has gone insane means what has happened is their mental world has become disconnected from the physical world. And that's why they live inside their head and they act to us as if they are insane. So basically, the common denominator in mental health problems is increasing misalignment between the mental world and the physical world. And so there are various ways for dealing with it. As I said, if there is a structural biochemical damage, then psychiatric intervention is not only recommended, it may be necessary. But sometimes by talking, psychotherapy is basically about talking. When you talk about spirituality involves also talking to understand and strengthen our intelligence. But it also involves purification. So the forces that cause the misalignment of the mind, they are decreased by the practice of spirituality. Now, is medication, how can it help? It helps when it is, especially, as I said, the brain is damaged, at that time it can help. Why is the mind designed in such a way that it is always distracting? Well, it is not designed in that way. It is we who have been distracted for many past lives. And that's why the distracting tendency is there. So the mind is like a software. And suppose we have visited particular sites repeatedly using our computer browser. And as soon as we type a particular browser site, it will go over there. Say, we have visited a particular site, bollywood.com, repeatedly. And then now we have heard about the Bhagavad Gita, we want to study the Bhagavad Gita. So we type B on our browser, we want to go to Bhagavad Gita, but as soon as you type B, bollywood.com comes up. Why? Because that's what we have chosen in the past. So So, like that, based on whatever we are distracted toward, that's what we go to. I'll talk about the three modes of material nature later. So, emotions are related to the mind. Emotions are not related to the intelligence. What the intelligence is meant to process the emotions and then act appropriately. That's why emotions, the mind itself is not intrinsically rational. The mind is driven by irrational drives. What can we do to control the mind? Persistence, intelligence, transcendence, as we discussed in the class. So, regarding the spiritual world, once we introduce the concept, we'll discuss at that time. How to be more attentive? Same thing. Persistence, intelligence, transcendence. Just keep doing those things. Be patient and try to find out some things which you can focus on to aid in the chanting. Maybe keep a picture of Krishna. Maybe have some quote about the holy name and the importance of meditation. Maybe have some spiritual stimulus that can. The mind doesn't focus only on the sound. Have the mind, if it can't focus on the point of concentration, have some circle of concentration on which the mind can focus. We will talk about false ego in a later class. The last question I cannot take at this point, but is question about why did chanting, if I was chanting but now I can't chant, because why did my chanting not create impressions to make it a habit or to make me comfortable by chanting? Yes, chanting is difficult. It is like the in meditation, the way to relaxation is through concentration. It's just like when we lift weights. Lifting weights is exhausting. It's not a picnic. But by lifting weights, gradually we become stronger. So chanting is basically we are getting Krishna, who is in one sense supremely heavy. We are invoking Krishna in our consciousness and then we are trying to focus on Krishna. So it's exercise. But through that exercise, we become stronger. And in general, if we find that we have lost interest in chanting, don't reduce bhakti to chanting alone. Try to find out something about Krishna that you feel attracted to. Say, for example, hearing classes, coming to satsangs, worshipping the deity. And stay connected with Krishna, at least in some way or the other. And so yena kena prakarena mana Krishna niveshayat. Once we maintain one connection with Krishna, gradually we can expand that connection. And we will be having a separate session on meditation. At that time, we'll discuss more about what all we can do to improve our meditation. But make sure that we stay connected with Krishna at whatever level we can. And for all of us, chanting is a struggle, but it's a struggle that purifies us. And rather than expecting that we will, just like when you go for a workout, every day the workout is a challenge. But although it's a challenge, it also has its benefits. So if you focus on chanting as, when will I get taste for chanting? Well, that will take a long time. We see chanting as a medication for us, for the mind, and we take the medicine not for so much for its taste but for its effect. So like that, if we see this primarily as a exercise, then we will be able to move forward. So thank you very much. There are some remaining questions that we will either discuss in the next session or we will address in between. I'll send the audio answers. Thank you. Hare Krishna.